way that Brand keeps talking, I feel like he's the one that's wanting to get up and preach this morning. Well, last week we noticed the short sermon, the prelude into chapter 12. And this morning we are going to be in Exodus chapter 12. And so we're getting into the good stuff. This is the last plague. Starting in verse 1 says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, In the tenth day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. They shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the houses wherein they shall eat it. They shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire. His head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, with your shoes on your feet, and with your staff in your hand. Ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover." So here we have the institution of the Passover started. This lamb, now hindsight, this lamb in hindsight, being 2020, of course, we know it symbolized Christ. Now, at the time, though, they would not know it. The Israelites here would not know that this is symbolic of Jesus being the Passover. Now the rules were that this was to be one lamb to a household, that they were to eat all that was that they could, if they weren't to leave any remaining. Now, if some did wind up getting remained, it was to be burned with fire, of course. So there was a provision made if that they couldn't all be eaten. Now, if the household was also too small, they were to get with their neighbors. Like our next door neighbor, he lives alone. And so instead of him killing a lamb and us killing a lamb, he would have to come over and be with us, and he would get a portion of our lamb. Now the lamb had to be perfect, no blemish, also had to be a male. And the blood of the lamb, and now this is the part that so many people remember about the houses being covered with the blood of the lamb. It was to be painted on the doorpost and on the upper doorpost. So the three sides of it were supposed to be painted, if you will, with the blood of the lamb on the frame of the door frame of the house. There was even a certain way to cook the lamb. Now, one thing they had to have was unleavened bread. They would have eaten with bitter herbs. And the way that they were to cook the lamb is roasting it over a fire. They weren't to boil it. Now, roasting it over a fire would have been quicker than boiling it as well. But this symbolism also has to do with it being, well, there's a few things here that we've got to notice. One thing, the symbolism here is on the side that's pretty obvious, is that they were to eat it with their shoes on, with their loins girt about, with their staff in their hand. They were eating in haste. This was symbolic of them being ready to leave Egypt. Now, we could have a whole sermon about how that they were supposed to be so eager, so ready to leave Egypt, that they ate the Passover lamb according to God's instructions in haste. They weren't sitting there. When you go to a restaurant to eat, we're getting into the colder temperatures. What do? You take off your coat. You're sitting there and you're relaxing. Sometimes if you go home, you take off your shoes. If you have slippers, you put them on. Your house or house slippers or house shoes. You get comfortable. You're relaxing. You're settling in for a little bit of a stay. The way that they were to eat, they were to eat ready to go. Now, where that we could get a whole sermon on this from is about how that when we leave, now about the whole symbolism of Egypt representing, you know, sin and coming out of sin, coming out of bondage, coming out of Egypt. That whole thing makes a picture. And as they were supposed to be eager to leave the land of Egypt, we'd be eager to leave the land of sin. There's a whole sermon that could be done on that. But I'll leave that to either another time or another sermon or someone else if they want to do it. But that's not the point of this sermon. But I'm just saying there's a good sermon there. The other thing is that them eating it with bitter herbs. Now, herbs are used to flavor food, to make it taste good. Bitter herbs, especially if you have too much of it, it can leave a bitter taste in the mouth. I know it seems redundant, but it makes it so you really don't want to eat it. But they had to eat it. If you stop and think about this for a minute, we know from last week that this last plague was the angel of death coming that would kill all the firstborn in Egypt. We have here the Passover, which is when God sees the blood of the lamb, he passes over their house. And rather than that someone in the house of Israel dying, you had the lamb die. The same way that Jesus went to the cross for us. And so the whole thing of eating the bitter herbs was them remembering, in a sense, if you will, the bitterness that had to be endured for them to go to be free. When we partake of the Lord's Supper, we are remembering the death. When we do this every first day of the week, we are remembering the death, burial, resurrection of Christ. We are remembering His sacrifice for us. We're remembering Him going to the cross for us and paying what should have been our punishment for sin. There's so many pictures here. So many good sermons that we have heard preached in the past. it's this chapter is so rich. And if I was to go in any particular direction and just stick with it, we could be here for a whole week or longer. But this is more of an informative sermon than a persuasive sermon. But it'd be interesting to come back and do some sermons based off of this. But we've got to move on. The point is that they were supposed to be ready to leave the land of Egypt. Then in verse 12, it says, "For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. Against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." They, once again, as we just noticed, they were covered by the blood of the Lamb. The Passover Lamb is the picture of us being covered by the blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus the Christ. Verse 14. "And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever." Now, a lot of people, they read this verse here, and they say, see, it's supposed to be forever. Okay, but there's also an earlier clause in here, if you take notice. It says, "And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations." Who was God talking to? He was talking to Moses and Aaron. He was talking to the children of Israel. And so it's supposed to be the children of Israel keeping this feast throughout their, the children of Israel's, generations. And as long as the children of Israel are God's chosen people, as long as they were His nation, then they were to keep it forever. Now, when the law changed, the priesthood changed, God's chosen people changed, and so no longer do we have to keep the Passover. We keep a different feast. We partake of the Lord's Supper every first day of the week. And that kind of jumps ahead a little bit, but just keep it in your mind. But then verse 15 says, 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. And in the first day there shall be an holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be a holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat, that only may be done of you. So they're not supposed to work on the first day and in the seventh day. No servile work. The only work that they're allowed to do is that which is required for them to be able to eat. Then verse 17 says, "And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall ye observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever." Once again, we have that same language. "Therefore ye shall observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month, at even," or in the evening, says that "ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 20th day of the month at even. 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses, for whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from your congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. Ye shall eat nothing leavened. In all your habitations ye shall eat unleavened bread. Now, I have not made comment about the unleavened bread and being cut off as of yet, because we're getting to this point. God was serious about the rules then. In the Old Testament, God was serious about the rules. But He's also serious about the rules now. You see, this is a point that many congregations don't get, and this is a point that I know the denominations don't get. And that this is why we study the Old Testament. It's true that it isn't law for us. The law has changed. The old law is a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. We've been over this with Paul and studying Romans and studying Hebrews. In fact, if you want to learn about the changing of the law, go just read the book of Hebrews. Go read the book of Hebrews. While the Old Testament isn't law for us, it does show us and remind us of the character of God. You see, the world loves, this is something the world loves to do. We were talking a little bit earlier outside of Bible class, a little bit in Bible class, about how the world loves to use little pithy sayings, sometimes to shut down conversation, oftentimes to shut down conversation. But the world loves to do certain things. And there's something that the world loves to do. And this, brethren, it makes me mad when the world does this. It makes me mad when the world does this. The world loves to have a God of the Old Testament that is harsh, that is evil, that is genocidal, that goes and tells the children of Israel to go to this particular land and utterly destroy the people. Don't leave a single one alive. But then they love to look at the New Testament and say, oh, well, there's a God of the New Testament that's mild and loving and meek and gentle. And they don't even realize their own bias. They don't even realize that they're trying to pit the Old Testament and the New Testament against each other. What they don't realize is the God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. The God of the New Testament is the God of the Old Testament. There's not two different gods. They are the two different. It's the same God. It's the same Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They are one in purpose. They are totally united. And then people start looking at that and then they try to say, oh, well, you had in the Old Testament God the Father who was harsh and stuff, and then the Son came in and usurped the authority of the Father. The height of arrogance. To assume that Jesus came in and usurped the authority of the Father. That is sinful. That is blasphemous. Especially when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. About to go to the cross. And he's praying to the Father and he says, he's crying. He knows he is about to endure one of the most horrific punishments that has ever fallen to someone. And he says to the Father, let this cup pass from me. Let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, let your will be done. He was saying, he was totally submissive to to the Father. It is the height of arrogance when Jesus came and he taught us submission to the will of God. He taught us, in the New Testament, it says submit one to another. And he washed the disciples' feet, and people are going to come in and try to say that he usurped the will of the Father. Brethren, when people have the audacity to say that there are two different gods, one of the Old Testament and one of the New, and the one of the New usurped the authority of the Old Testament, brethren, that should make your blood boil. We should be filled with righteous indignation when people start spouting that nonsense. And as people have a bias today, it's a bias because of what they currently want to portray God as. Brethren, I submit that you look at the world's portrayal of God and they don't have a clue what they're talking about. They don't have a clue what they're talking about. They want to portray God in the Old Testament as being harsh and evil and wanting to just wipe out folks, striking people dead. What about when God spared Noah and his family because of Noah's obedience? What about when God set his people free from bondage in Egypt? What about when he took care of Joseph? What about God when he took care of David? When King Saul, delusional, crazed King Saul, was after David to kill him? And then they want to portray Jesus in the New Testament as this weak, frail man who is just wants to go along to get along. And they totally ignore the Jesus in the New Testament, the side of Jesus in the New Testament that was filled with righteous indignation at what the people at the sin that was going on in the temple with the money changers, and he overthrew the tables and he drove them out with a bullwhip. The God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. The God of the New Testament is the God of the Old Testament. And throughout time, He has had rules. He has had laws to govern His people. And there are consequences for not following His rules. And just because they're not always clearly stated doesn't mean that they're not there. Back in the Old Testament, you know, it's like when you stop and think about it, this makes perfect logical sense. The Old Testament was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. And in the Old Testament, what do you have? You have God going through, telling them what to do, what not to do, and the consequences for if they don't do it, they'll be cut off from Israel, they'll be cut off from this, they'll be cut off from that, if they don't obey. And in the New Testament, what do we have? We got simply telling us what He wants or what He doesn't want. If you've ever wondered, let's stop and let's pause for a second real quick and let's put this on today's terms to make it clear for everybody to understand. And this is mainly for people that try to watch sermons online that may not fully grasp what I'm saying. The Old Testament is like God walking in to a fast food restaurant and saying, I want the burger, I want the hamburger with no cheese and ketchup. I don't want the chicken sandwich, I don't want the fish sandwich, I don't want the chicken strips. Going on down the line. The New Testament is God walking into the same fast food restaurant and saying, I want the hamburger with no cheese and ketchup. He doesn't have to say what he doesn't want. He doesn't have to say, if you don't do what I want, then I'm not going to pay for this sandwich if you don't give me what I order. He doesn't have to go through all that because it's the schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. He expected mankind to grow up a little during the Old Testament to get to a point where he doesn't have to go through all this. He was going through here telling them if they were to eat unleavened bread, if any of them ate leavened bread, then they're going to be cut off from Israel. We're supposed to have gotten to a point where God just says, on this particular time, eat the unleavened bread, and he doesn't have to tell us all this other stuff. We're supposed to have grown up. Yet with the way that people act, you'd think that... But God has always had rules. He's always had laws. And he expects us to follow them. Now verse 21. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover. That's kill the Passover lamb. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and strike the lintel and two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come into your houses to smite you. And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. And it shall come to pass when ye shall come to the land which the Lord will give you according as he hath promised, ye shall keep this service. And it shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service, that ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bowed the head and worshipped. And everybody pay attention to verse 28. Everybody pay attention to verse 28. And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. I want everyone to, if you have your Bibles, take a look back in Genesis chapter 6. This should be very familiar to you if you've been, if you were here or watched the sermons we had on Genesis. This should be very, very familiar to you. Yes, it's talking about Noah in Genesis 6, and I've got to get over to it. My fingers don't want to work right this morning. Genesis 6, verse 22. Okay. Thus did Noah according to all that God commanded him, so did he. You find similar language there and here in Exodus. What happened through Noah's obedience? He escaped the flood. What happened with the Israelites? They escaped the last plague. Obedience to God. If you want a theme for the for this sermon, if you want a theme for it, people sometimes say, well, what is the theme? If you want a theme for the sermon, here is the theme for the sermon. Obedience to God always equates escaping destruction. If Noah wanted to escape the flood, he had to do according to all that God commanded him, so did he. The Israelites, they wanted to escape. They did as the Lord had commanded. So did they. And people, if you want to escape hell, then let it be said at your funeral. You can get a preacher up to preach all the fancy words and talk about how you were a nice person, how you did this, that, and the other, and how you served on the board committee of whatnot and stuff like that, and they can try to preach you into heaven. But brethren, if it can't be said of you that you did all that God commanded you, so did you, then guess what? Heaven is not your destination. If you want to get to heaven, it has to be able to be said of you. Thus did, insert your name here, according to all that God commanded, thus did he or she. And when the Bible says something plainly, one needs to be careful going against it. Be very careful arguing against it. Excuse me. I mean, we've been studying traditions of men versus the Word of God in Bible class. And we talked a little bit about denominations and how that there are certain, you know, families that can be steeped in denominations and so forth like that. Well, I got to tell you, I've got to tell you this morning. I got to tell you this morning. That it's not a case of it was good enough for my mama or daddy, it's good enough for me, anything like that. It's not good, you know, it's none of that. When you stand before God in judgment, God's not going to say how much money's in your wallet. Were you this, that, or the other? What did you do for a living? Now, to a certain extent. Like, you can't be a stripper and go to heaven, of course. You know, can't be a bartender and go to heaven. But it's like you have to come out of that sin. But, so that's why I say to a certain extent. But God's not going to look at you and say, was your mama and daddy a faithful so-and-so, or your mom and daddy didn't do this or the other. No, it's all, if when you stand before God in judgment, it all comes back on you. And either you obeyed all that God commanded you to do, or you didn't. There is no in between. Remember the thing. Obedience to God equates escaping destruction. Verse 29, it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants, and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not. Pay very close attention, because this is the plague that breaks Egypt. There was not a house where there was not one dead. Brethren, if a chill didn't just go up your spine, then there is something wrong with you. Because the first thing that just flashed into my mind . We're here in Tennessee, in the state of Tennessee. It doesn't even have to be all of Tennessee. It could be West Tennessee. It could be everybody in Fayette County. It could be everybody in Summer. I tell you, if we woke up in the morning and one of every, there was not a house in Somerville where someone did not die. If we woke up tomorrow morning, it would be on the news. It would be on the news. That a plague had hit, and the firstborn of that everyone, every house in Somerville had someone to die in. There would be a lot of mourning, and Peebles Cemetery would be backed up. Now that's our town alone. And you better believe it'd make the news. It'd make the Mid-South news. Now picture an entire country. In all the land of Egypt. There was no one in Egypt spared. When I say no one in Egypt spared, there was not a house where someone did not die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne to the captive that was in the dungeon. Now stop and think about that. Stop and think about that. Let's put it into perspective. There was no amount of money, no amount of power, no amount of prestige. There was no bargaining. It didn't matter how low you thought of yourself or how high you thought of yourself. If you were in Egypt, somebody in your house died. And it was the firstborn. I know we've made reference to the Exodus movies, those movies that have to do about stuff. And there are certain parts of the movies that really capture, that really have their oomph moments. And the Exodus Gods and Kings movie, it caught a lot of flack, but there's two things that really struck well on that. And one was where that the character that played God made reference when Moses essentially in the movie asked him why he was doing what he was doing. He was saying, because Pharaoh sits on his throne pretending to be God. And so that really caught the whole thou shalt not have any other gods before me, the jealousy of God, that caught that very well. But one other scene really struck me when the 10th plague hit and all in Egypt, you know, every house in Egypt had the firstborn to die. And Pharaoh called to Moses. In the movie, he went to Moses. That's not exactly what happened in the biblical account, but he went to Moses, and he's like, you serve a God that would kill children. And he was like horrified to the extent that God would go to set the Israelites free. And the look on Pharaoh's face when Moses told him, now yes, this is in the movie, but when he told him that there was not a single person who died of the house of the children of Israel, the look on Pharaoh's face just said it all. Now that they portrayed that really, really well in the movie. I can only imagine the sheer horror on Pharaoh's face when Egypt woke up that next morning and every single house had someone to die. And then word gets to him that the children of Israel didn't have a single person to die. I told y'all that this is the plague that broke Pharaoh. And if you really sit down and try, I'm failing at my words. I mean, my responsibility as a preacher is to convey through words, through teaching, the scriptures, to try to persuade obedience to people, try to persuade people to obey. And yet I find myself after having studied it. And realizing it, and I lack the words. I lack the descriptive powers to even accurately portray these things. The best thing that I could tell anyone to do would be to try to begin to comprehend the extent of this plague. And it will hit you. And as a Christian, and I sit around and I look around on a daily basis, and I see the number of people in my own country who are lost in sin, and knowing the destruction that is at the gates, that people so ignorantly ignore. And yes, I know what I just said. I can't help but just be left. It's indescribable. And not in a good way. This is the other sermon that we have here. That this sermon, I didn't intend for it to become this, but it kind of became it anyway. Is we have a picture as far back here in Exodus of the destruction of the world, of the end of the world, of what's going to happen when Jesus comes back. Is this was the judgment. If you go back up and you look, find it real quick. In verse 12, God said, I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. This was God executing judgment against Egypt. Now we can look about nations, you know, rising and falling and all that sort of stuff. And that's another lesson, but This was God having judgment day on Egypt. We know from the scriptures that judgment day for the whole world is coming. And either you're covered by the blood of the Lamb, or you're going to be part of that great cry that's going to go up, that's going to make this cry in Egypt that went up. We heard it described as such a great cry that none like it has been heard before or since in the land of Egypt. What about the great cry that's going to rise up when so many people stand before the judgment seat of Christ? When judgment for the whole world comes. Brethren, ladies, gentlemen, those that watch online, you have got to seriously stop and ask yourself, am I following all of what God has commanded? Am I covered by the blood of the Lamb? Have I honestly delved into God's Word, or have I been indoctrinated with what men want me to hear? Have I honestly heard the Word of God, Romans 10:17? Have I honestly believed it? And this is the thing about belief. It's not just a casual sitting back thing. It's based off of evidence. Do you believe that what is said about Christ is true? John 8:20. Have you repented of sins? Have you honestly repented of sins? I mean, the guy is not a... he's not a Christian. He's a denominational teacher. But he said it excellent. And I'm going to steal the way that he said it. If you have claimed to become a Christian and haven't given up anything, you need to go back and re-examine. And that's what repentance is. Acts 17:30. If you haven't, have you publicly pledged your allegiance to others? Your allegiance, in front of others, your allegiance to Christ. Excuse me. Romans 10:9-10. Have you confessed that you believe that He is the Son of God? That is a good confession. Have you been covered by the blood of the Lamb through baptism? Romans 6:3-4. And I love Romans 6:3-4 on it because of the description that's there. A lot of preachers love to do like Mark 16:16. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be condemned. But I love Romans 6:3-4 because it describes what it is. It's a burial. You're buried with Christ. You bury the old man of sin. And when you come up out of the waters of baptism, you walk in newness of life. But then have you lived faithfully if you've done so? Brethren, I submit that if you haven't done these things... friends, listeners, I submit, if you haven't done these things, go and look them up in the Scriptures. Go look it up in the Scriptures. Go look it up, and then you sit back and you ask yourself, have I done these things? And if you haven't, you are not covered by the blood of the Lamb. And you will be part of, and if you don't do what's right, if you don't do what's right with the time that God has given to you, then you will be part of that great cry that's going to rise up. You will be part of the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. Verse 31, he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as ye have said. Look, that's what Pharaoh said. He called for Moses and Aaron by night. That very night he called for them and he said, get up and go forth and get out from among my people. You and the whole children of Israel, go serve the Lord. As you have said, take your flocks, verse 32, also take your flocks and your herds, as ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also. Verse 33, and the Egyptians were urgent upon the people that they might send them out of the land in haste, for they said, we be all dead men. And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs being bound up and their clothes upon their shoulders. And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses, and they borrowed of the Egyptians jewels of silver, jewels of gold, and raiment. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they lent unto them such things as they required. And notice what it says. And they spoiled the Egyptians. Told you those jewels were spoils of war. Verse 37, and the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 on foot that were men beside children. And a mixed multitude went up also with them in flocks and herds, even very much cattle. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry, neither had they prepared for themselves any victual. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years, and it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day, it came to pass that all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. A couple of things we need to notice here. When they went from Ramses to Succoth, Ramses, this is where that they had that change. The city was known as another name back then. And a scribe changed the name from the old city to the new city, which was Ramses, which was built on the same location. And it was so that they would know that this is where that they, you know, geographically where that they came from. It'd be like if, for example, Memphis had a name change. It'd say it's Memphis, Tennessee. And then 500 years from now, the name, or 100 years from now, the name changes to Madison, Tennessee, instead of Memphis, Tennessee. Well, 500 years down the line, if people, let's say that they've forgotten what Memphis was, where it was, but they know where Madison was. And so, someone was writing a book about it, and it's like, oh, well, they went to Madison, Tennessee. The Langfords moved to Madison, Tennessee. So anyway, that's just the idea of how that, that's the idea of what happened. That's what happened on this. And notice that they were thrust out of Egypt. And this is one thing that the movies always show. We talked a little bit about the movies. But the movies always show the people gathering their things. And they're walking out and it's daylight and everything like that. No, they went, it was nighttime. The very night of the Passover, before they even, they had the dough ready to bake. Before the dough could even be leavened. And they weren't going to leaven it purposefully, but before it could be leavened, I mean, that very night, that the people died. There was this great cry that came up out of Egypt, true enough. And Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron, and he said, get your stuff, get your people, and get out. And don't waste any time doing it. It said that they didn't have time to tarry because they were thrust out of the land of Egypt. They didn't even have time to prepare food to go. It's the thing, like, for example, it's like if I'm Pharaoh and I tell you, let's say you're Moses, I'm Pharaoh, and I tell you, get out of the land, get out of Tennessee altogether. And you say, well, can I stop by McDonald's and get me a cup of coffee to go, to wake up? And I say, you can't even get a cup of coffee. You got to get out now. That's what happened back then. Now, this plague was directed against all the gods of Egypt. Verse 12. That's a central verse here. But it's against all the gods of Egypt. It would show the total inability of the gods of Egypt to protect their subjects in the face of unparalleled tragedy. This plague was potentially more devastating than all of the other plagues combined. And the reasons why are thus. The firstborn was not only the heir of a double portion of the father's inheritance traditionally back then, but he also represented special qualities of life. The law of primogeniture decreed that the firstborn son would inherit the major portion of a family estate, and when the father died, the death of the firstborn son would cripple a family legally and emotionally. This would have been humiliating to Isis, the winged goddess of fertility, Meskhenet, the goddess who presided at the birth of children, Hathor, one of the seven deities who attended the birth of children, Min, the goddess of procreation, Selket, the guardian of life, and to Renenutet, the cobra goddess and guardian of Pharaoh. Not only this attack was against the gods, but also against Pharaoh. It undermined his immortality through his inability to protect his son, who was considered a god as well. And it also undermined his ability to provide unity and protection over the land of Egypt. The Hebrew word for plague describes a mark. Comes from the Hebrew root word meaning to touch, to reach, or to strike. Now previously, God had not revealed how many plagues there would be, and now He reveals this will be the last one and that it will leave a mark on Egypt. In Psalms 135:8 and 136:10, the death of the firstborn is the only plague mentioned at all. And it's probably because this plague made such an impression on future generations. I told y'all ahead of time that this is the plague that would break Egypt. Did I not? Throughout all the plagues of Pharaoh just completely refusing to let the children of Israel go. This is the plague that just made him go, not just from you can't leave to get out. That is what this plague, and the reason why I keep looking at you is because you keep looking at me. But that is a complete reversal. And it's also interesting to know that even the animal's offspring are included and the distinction. I mean, it wasn't just people. It was beasts as well. We noticed that last week. This plague also is a stark reminder and mark as well, in that the previous plagues, Israel was left untouched as a nation, but now he required an act of obedience, an act of faith on Israel's part to escape the judgment. We just noticed that. And now Pharaoh himself was left without an heir to the throne. And this would be devastating to a king, especially one who was the representation of the god Ra. I'm going to read a quote right here. It says, following the death of Thutmose III, his son Amenhotep II took the throne and ruled for at least 26 years. This king, according to the early date of the Exodus, would have been the Pharaoh of the Exodus and the one who lost his firstborn son in the final judgment of God. Some have seen a relationship between the death of Amenhotep's firstborn son and the well-known dream stela of Thutmose IV, his son and successor to the throne. In this document, the god Harumkot promised the throne of Thutmose IV on the condition that he restored the exposure of the Great Sphinx, which apparently had been largely covered by drifting sand. It is their view that this dream represents an attempt at legitimizing his right to the throne, since he was apparently not the firstborn son. So basically what this is saying is this Pharaoh's son, who was not the firstborn, in order to try to legitimize him sitting on the throne, that he would have said he had this dream that from a god that told him to uncover the Sphinx. So I mean, it's crazy, but I mean, people will go to ends to try to, you know. I mean, it's like, I'm not bringing politics into this, and I reserve my comments for things in private regarding how that I personally feel about the way that that the Hillary Clinton supporters, after she did lose the election, are trying to push for faithless electors and stuff like that to try to get them to overturn the thing where that they have to go with the state, what their state said that they want them to vote for president. They're wanting to try to get. They hate it so bad that Hillary did lose that they're trying to overturn things. And there's that. I'm leaving my own personal comments in private for that, but it's the point I'm trying to make is that people will go to extreme ends to legitimize their positions, and it happened as far back. It happened even as back as in Exodus here. Pharaoh let Israel go to sacrifice to their God, but it's not clear whether he intended to free them, then changed his mind, or only gave them permission to go and come back and then pursued them because they fled, as what this website says. No, there is no... I did get some of this information from a website that told about the gods that it struck, that God struck against. No, there is no... thing. There is no confusion. Pharaoh told the nation of Israel to get out. But then Pharaoh, once again, in his anger and bitterness and hardness of head and hardness of heart, he pursued them with his army. But that's going to be later. Not in this sermon. It's going to be in a later sermon. And verse 42 says, reads, it is a night to be so much observed unto the Lord for bringing them out from the land of Egypt. It is that night. This is Exodus 12, 42. It is that night of the Lord to be observed of all the children of Israel and their generations. When the Lord said unto Moses and Aaron, this is the ordinance of the Passover. There shall no stranger eat thereof, but every man's servant that is bought for money, when thou hast circumcised him, then shall he eat thereof. A foreigner and a hired servant shall not eat thereof. In one house shall it be eaten. Thou shalt not carry forth aught the flesh abroad or out of the house, neither shall ye break a bone thereof. Speaking about not breaking any of the bones, when Jesus went to the cross, there was not a bone broken. Verse 47, all the congregation of Israel shall keep it. And when the stranger shall sojourn with thee, and will keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it, and he shall be as one that is born in the land. For no uncircumcised person shall eat thereof. One law shall be to him that is homeborn, and unto the stranger that sojourneth among you. Thus did all the children of Israel as the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. And it came to pass the selfsame day that the Lord did bring the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt by their armies. And so we see that all that would follow the will of God would have to partake of the Passover, whether they be of the nation of Israel or a proselyte, someone who converted to Judaism. And we don't keep the Passover because the symbol was fulfilled in Christ. He fulfilled the law and the prophets. We follow different ritual, as we notice. We follow a different feast, the Lord's Supper, which also uses unleavened bread, incidentally. All these symbolize the purity and the sinlessness of Christ. And just as the nation of Israel, proselytes to the law of Moses, would have to be circumcised, we don't have that today as a religious law. We have the law of Christ, which has us being baptized after listening to the Word of God, believing in Christ, repenting of sins, and confessing fidelity to Jesus. After that, we have to live faithful. We've noticed the passages earlier in the sermon. Brethren, friends, people that listen, go back and study this chapter. Go back and study the Scriptures and see whether you're covered by the blood of the Lamb. If you are covered by the blood of the Lamb, you have the responsibility of living faithful. If you are not, you know what you have to do. If anyone has need to be covered by the blood of the Lamb, do not hesitate, do not wait. If you have fallen from the truth, then you can repent and ask for forgiveness as Simon, once known as the sorcerer, did in Acts 8. If anyone has need to respond to the Lord's invitation, don't wait. Don't wait. Tomorrow could be too late. If anyone has need to respond, please do so while the rest of us stand and sing.